Hello everybody and welcome back. Now, right now what we want to do is basically just start with some of the auxiliary modules that are in Metasploit framework. So we want to basically scan the machine with MSF console. Now let us first of all start the MSF console. Now if you didn't start the PostgreSQL before this, start it so this can run faster. But while this is starting, I also want to start my OWASP virtual machine. Now, if you install the Metasploitable before, whether it is Metasploitable 1 or Metasploitable 2, you can also run that one as well. Now, as I said before, I cannot get Metasploitable to run for some reason, so I'm using OWASP. I will show you some of the attacks you can perform on Metasploitable as well. So those of you who are opening that machine right now can also do something, but some of the attacks are also similar for the OWASP and for the Metasploitable. So just start any of those two machines. Now I will make sure to mention when the attack is directed to the Metasploitable and when the attack is directed to the OWASP virtual machine. So we wait for this to open. This shouldn't take too long, as we remember this is a small virtual machine. It will prompt us with entering username and password. Which is, I believe, username is root and the password is OWASPBWA. Let me just see if this has opened. Okay, so this has opened. We get the standard interpreter, or not interpreter, standard command line tool. And we also get this banner right here. So let us first log in into the OWASP. Hopefully it will prompt us with username and password soon enough. Here it is. So the username is root and the password is OWASPBWA. So OWASPBWA. And now we are good to go. Let us just first check the IP address of this so we know it. So the IP address of OWASP virtual machine is 192.168.1.2. Good. Now, as I said before, you can run a bunch of different commands, or basically all the commands that you run from regular terminal, you can also run from the Metasploit framework command line. So what we want to do is, let's first clear the screen, and what we want to do, let's first take a good scan at the OWASP virtual machine. Now we covered nmap before, so what we want to do right now is nmap minus sv, so we can get the version from the services running on certain ports. And then we specify the IP address of our OWASP virtual machine, or in your case, if you're using Metasploitable, of your Metasploitable machine. So execute this, and now we wait for this to finish. It should prompt us with all of the open ports, it should prompt us with the services running on the open ports, and it should prompt us with the version of those services running, which can be useful, especially when you use Metasploit framework. So what we will do is we will try some of the certain attacks on this. Now we can see that the scan has finished it in 18.3 seconds. So we get the open ports, and let's start off with the SSH port. Now we have a bunch of these other ports such as 139.445 running Samba SMBD version 3.2.4, which is also a vulnerable software. You also have it on Metasploitable, I believe, the same version. I will show you how you can exploit it later on. But for now on, let us start off by trying to get in over the SSH. So we can see that the service running is SSH on port 22, and the version is OpenSSH 5.3p1 Debian 3 Ubuntu 4. So what we will do is we will use the auxiliary module that is in Metasploit framework, and we will try it to brute force the SSH on port 22 from our OWASP virtual machine. Or if you're running Metasploitable, once again, from your Metasploitable, the process is the same. So let us try with searching SSH. Now this will print us all of the available exploits, auxiliary modules, post exploit modules for the SSH. Now, let us scroll a little bit up, since we do not want post and we do not want exploit, we want some of these modules right here. So, auxiliary DOS, we have the auxiliary DOS Windows SSH sys, or basically some KEX exchange, not really sure what that is. It says multi-server key exchange denial of service, okay. But this is on Windows, so we do not really need it. What we are searching for is a scanner And scanner has to be the login. So here it is, the auxiliary scanner SSH SSH login. Now it doesn't have the date when it came out. The rank is, it is ranked as normal, and it says the SSH login check scanner, which basically means the SSH bruteforcer. Now you can also, for example, check the SSH version before you start that. So auxiliary scanner SSH version scanner. So let's first of all start with that one. I believe it will give us the same thing that the nmap gave us, which is the version of the SSH. Now you can use this instead of nmap, since sometimes nmap won't give you the version, and I believe this one is actually more detailed. So as we saw in the previous videos, in order to pick any of these, you just type use and then the name of the module itself. So auxiliary scanner SSH and then slash SSH underscore version. And what we want to do is show our available options. So we can see that we have four different options and they are all required. Most of them are already selected for us. So the rport, for example, is selected as 22, which is good. SSH is most likely always and also by default is running on port 22. If it is not, you would want to change this. Threads is the number of threads basically running during this process. Now the more threads, the more faster this process will go. So depending on your power of your virtual machine, you can select, for example, let's select set threads 3. Now we also covered the set command, so you set basically all of these options with just set command and then the name of the option you want and then the number. So we want 3 threads. So if you were to, for example, type show options right now, you would see that the threads are now selected to 3. The only thing that we need to select right now is the R hosts. So the R hosts is basically the target address for our OS virtual machine. It is basically an IP address of your target. So set rhosts, we know it is 192.168.1.2. Oops, .1.2. And now if we show our options again in order to check if everything is good, we will be able to run this. Now if you just run this, so just type here run, this will probably, here it is, this will print out the SSH version that it is running on the target software, or on target port 22. As we can see, SSH version, this one, and it gives some bunch of other options as well that could be potentially useful to you. Now, this is a simple scan that we did for the first one, but now let's actually try to brute force this SSH on port 22. So let us go to our available auxiliary modules, and what we want to use is the SSH login one. So just select the auxiliary SSH scanner, then SSH underscore login, copy it, let's go down here and let's do the use and then our module. So copy paste it and we can see that it changed the module. So let's clear the screen so we can see stuff a little bit better and let's show our options. Now you can see, unlike the last one, this one has a lot of different modules, or not modules, a lot of different options that we need to specify. Now some of them are required and some of them are not. For example, blank passwords are not required. Brute force speed is required and we will actually select that to be 5. There's no need to actually make that more. I mean, this we will first of all use a simple password list, so we will not need a higher speed for this. The next things we need, these are all not required. Password, a specific password to authenticate with, no. Well, basically you would use this if you already knew the password, so I don't see the point of this option right here. What we do want is the rhosts, same in the previous scan, so just type here set rhosts and then the IP address of our target machine. So 192.168.1.2, I believe. Let me just check it once again. Yeah, it is .2. And also what you would want to set is basically, let's set again threads to be 3. So set threads 3, our port is correct and it is 22, stop on success, false. stop guessing when a credential works for a host. So you want to set this to true, since there is no really point in continuing the brute force unless you want to run multiple accounts after you find a host that actually works, so credentials that are useful. So we type here set stop on success, so you can just press tab in order for it to fill the rest of the name, and you can set this from false to true. And we can see that stop on success is now set to true. Verbose, you also want to set to true, so you can see all of the attempts that they are running. Now, you do not need to, basically, if you want, I always set it to true, so I can see the attempts of brute force that we covered already. So just set verbose. Again, you can press tab to finish, and then true. And now, if I type show options once again, we should have all of our options set and ready to go. Now, I believe there is something else we need to use, which is the, yeah, of course, we are not set to go. We need to use a password list, since this doesn't have a password list pre-specified, I believe. So what we want to use is basically, let us try to find a simple password list. So let's open up a second terminal. So new window. And we know that there are some passwords in the user share word lists. Now, let me view this or zoom this in. If I type here ls, you can see a bunch of these. Of course, we won't use the rockyou.txt, that would take forever. These large passwords are most likely the best choice for the Wi-Fi cracking. For the brute forcing, it's really not that good of a choice, since it's not as fast as the Wi-Fi cracking, it's not as nearly as fast. So what we want to do is go to the Metasploit, type here ls, and we will see some of the password lists that are in Metasploit. So we can choose any, basically any we want, so we do not need to really crack the SSH, we just need to show you the process of cracking it, and we will choose any password list we want. So let's say we choose, for example, this one, mirai_user_pass.txt. Now what that means, I believe, is that it also has both user and password. Yeah, it has both user and password separated with the space. So we will use that, and we will see the available option for that right here, which would be the user pass file. So file containing users and passwords separated by space, one pair per line, which is exactly what we selected. So we need to set this option right here. So let us set that option, set user pass file, and then we specify the path to the word list. So it was user share word lists, then Metasploit, I believe, and then Mirai user, and then another underscore, and then pass. So we set the path to our brute force list, or basically password and username list. And now, if we clear and show options once again, I believe now we should really be good to go. So let us run this. We press here run, and it should start brute forcing the SSH on port 22. As we can see, it is starting different types of the usernames and passwords, and it is going by that list that we specified. So these are all failed ones, and if it reaches one that actually exists, it will stop and it will prompt us with a success. So here we can see root, admin, 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 and root, root, and some of the other passwords. Now, I'm not really sure how many passwords are in this list, so we will not be waiting for this to finish. I just wanted to show you some of the different types of SSH auxiliary modules that you can use. So we saw how we can actually scan the version of SSH, and we also saw how we can brute force the SSH. Now, you can actually try this both on Metasploitable and on the OWASP virtual machine. I'm not really sure if this password list has username and password for those machines, but it doesn't really matter, since the process of attacking is the most important. So now you can use any password list you want and actually hope that you will brute force the SSH. So that would be it about this tutorial. In the next tutorial, we will cover another auxiliary module that we will use to attack another service running on our OS virtual machine. So that would be it for this tutorial, and I hope I see you in the next one. Bye.